Hello everyone, I am Dr. Andre Pallavi. Today I am going to handle a session on microcontrollers module 4. This is regarding 8051 timers and serial port. The syllabus under module 4 consists of 8051 timers and counters, wherein we are talking about the operation of the timers and counters, the ALP to generate a pulse using mode 1 and a square wave using mode 2 on a port pin. The serial communication of 8051. Under this, we are talking about the basics of serial data communication, the RS-232 standard, then the 9-pin RS-232 signals, the description, followed by assembly and C programming of the serial port to transmit a message and to receive the data serially. The textbooks for this is the Mazidi textbook from Pearson, then the Ayala textbook. The reference books are from Manish K. Patel and Raj Kamal. Apart from this, textbooks and reference books which have been specified in syllabus. So we have also used the 8051 reference manual. That is Intel MCS AT 51 microcontroller family users manual. The learning objectives of this module are, at the end of this course or of this module, students will be able to list the timers and their control registers in 8051, program the timers for any desired delay, then use timers as counters to count external events, then use the timers to generate square waves with the different duty cycles and frequencies. Coming to serial communication, they'll be able to explain the protocol, then also set the baud rate for transmission and reception, and program the 8051 in assembly and C for serial data communication, along with interfacing 8051 with RS-232 connectors. So just let us recap. So this is a block diagram of 8051. So in the block diagram of 8051, we have already seen the heart of it, that is the ALU with its registers, the AB, program status, PSW, PC, program counter, DPTF, and so on. Along with this, we also have studied the memory. The memory, there are three parts. One is the ROM, then the RAM, and in the RAM, we have two parts. That is the general purpose RAM and the special purpose area. Apart from the memory and the ALU, we have what are known as the peripherals. 8051 is a microcontroller. On chip of this microcontroller, we have the peripherals such as the timers and the serial port for serial communication. The parallel communication is through this four I/O ports, the P0, P2 to P3. So this is about the parallel communication. In this module, we are talking only about this timers and the serial port communication. Both these are peripherals. So peripherals are, they can work in parallel with the ALU. They will be using, in some cases, the same oscillator, the crystal oscillator, which generates a clock frequency. The same clock frequency will be used by the timer as well as the serial port, and they will be working in parallel with the ALU. So let us look at the operation. In 8051, there are two 16-bit timer and counter registers, as we have seen in the block diagram. They're labeled as timer 0 and timer 1. Next, we're talking about the difference between a timer and counter. Though we have the two 16-bit registers, these two 16-bit registers can be programmed to work as a timer, and they can also be programmed to work as a counter. So when do you say it's in timer mode? It is in a timer mode when it counts the internal clock pulses. And if it is counting the external clock pulses, then it is known as a counter. The input to the register, it's a register which keeps counting up. And if it counts the number of input clock pulses, then it is known as a timer. it is counting the external clock pulses, external to the 8051, then it is a counter. The two 16-bit counters or timers, timer 0 and timer 1, they are controlled. You have registers to control them, to set them to a certain value, to read and also to configure. So all this will be studying in detail. Coming to the functions, generically they can be used to calculate the time between events, and they can count the events or the clock pulses. They can generate baud rates for the serial port. So this is your timer. For example, if I take one timer, it's a 16-bit register. The 16-bit register, I can say that it is TLX, the lower part, lower 8-bit register, THX. The THX is your higher part of the register. And now the total 16-bit register can be used as only 8-bit register, or it can be used as a 13-bit register or a 16-bit register, depending on the mode. So the modes will configure the 16-bit TLX and THX together as either a 16-bit register or a 13-bit counter or an 8-bit counter. So to this register, you give the clock pulses. These are the clock pulses, and the output is the TFX. So we have the hardware. What does the hardware consist of? The hardware consists of a 16-bit register. That 16-bit timer register is divided into two parts. The lower 8-bit register is known as TLX. The upper 8-bit register is known as THX. So to this 16-bit register, you give an input clock. These are known as the clock pulses. You give an input clock. And after the operation, the operation also uses one TFX. This is a timer interrupt flag. This flag is set when the timer register overflows. So let us look at the operation of this timer. This, as I said, the timer register, if I consider only the TLX portion and a TLX of timer 0. As we have already stated, 8051 has two timers, timer 0 and timer 1. So if I consider only TL0, timer 0 with its lower register, it is 8 bits. It can work as a hexadecimal up counter. So these are the input clock pulses, and initially I assume that the register is cleared. So the 8 bits of this TL0, this is the lower 4 bits of TL0, this is upper 4 bits of TL0, all are 0000. Next, when I give an input clock pulse 1, the register counts 1. So in hex, it is 0, 1. D0 is 1. The rest are all zeros. The next clock pulse, so when the next second clock pulse comes, the register is incremented by one more. So 1 becomes 2, and the count value will be 0, 2. Or in terms of bits, D7 to D4 is 0, 0. D3 to D0 is 0, 0, 1, 0. Similarly, 3 is 0000011, that is the 03. Suppose if it's a 25th count in BCD, in hexadecimal it is 19, and this is a value of TL0, TL1. The max count in this TL0, 8 bits are when all the 8 bits are ones. So you have 111111. So in hexadecimal value it is FF, and in count value it is 255. The total count it can count is from 0 to 255, it can count up to 256 clock pulses, or from 00 to FF. How many input clock pulses it can count? It can count up to 255. After FF, the next clock pulse will make FF to roll to 0. It will overflow to 00. So once it overflows to 00, the timer interrupt flag will be set. And this can be used, this interrupt flag will interrupt the 8051. It will interrupt the 8051. And the 8051, the ALU, the CPU, can take some action. This will be done in parallel. The 8051 will keep working. The CPU will keep working. The main program will be working. The timer will be initialized. And what does this timer do? It will keep counting the input clock pulses. And once the input clock pulses overflows, then it will set the timer flow. So now let us look at our timer operation. So in the timer operations, what do we need? You need pulses. So the pulses are the clock or external pulse signal given as input to the timer peripheral. And each clock pulse will increment the count in the timer register, as we have seen. And these pulses are counted by the timer register. And finally, if the size is 8 bits, the maximum count, as we have seen, is FF, that is 256. Similarly, for 16 bits, the maximum value is all 16 bits 111, that is 4Fs. So the total count it can do is 2 power 16, that is 65,536. This also we have covered when the timer register overflows from the maximum value. The maximum value can be FF in 8-bit mode, or it can be 4Fs in 16-bit mode. So when it overflows from the maximum value to 00, or it may overflow, if you had set an initial value, I want to count only 100, then I have to have an initial value, which is maximum value minus 100. So it will overflow to either 00 or initial value. The timer interrupt flag is set. So when is the TFX, the timer interrupt flag set? When the timer register overflows from its maximum value. And this is used for many purposes. As I said, you can use it to provide a time delay. You can use it to count the number of events, etc. This is one more way. We have said the timers is incremented by one for every machine cycle. So the machine cycle in 8051 consists of 12 pulses. The pulses are provided by the internal clock frequency. Assume that the Intel crystal clock that is used is 11.0592 megahertz. This is a crystal clock. And this clock pulses, 12 such clock pulses. So the 12 such clock pulses will consist of one machine cycle. The 8051 will count the machine cycles. So every 11 megahertz divided by 12 is the number of machine cycles in a second. And the timer will count how many times? 921600 times a second. The timer will be incremented. So many clock pulses. We are assuming now that I'll say that the machine cycle is one clock pulse. Rather, one machine cycle consists of 12 pulses from the crystal oscillator. So the crystal oscillator or the crystal clock, which is of 11 megahertz, will provide the reference. 12 such pulses will consist of one machine cycle. And the timer is counting the number of these machine cycles. And one machine cycle, we will say that is equal to one clock pulse. Little bit calculations. The count that is required is the time required in seconds multiplied by the crystal frequency divided by 12. The F here is the crystal frequency. This is a small exercise. How many times should the timer be incremented to get 0.05 seconds? Assume I'm counting 1, 2, 3, 4. So one is when I get the first machine cycle or the first clock pulse. Two is when I get the second machine cycle. Three is when I if I have to delay or spend some 0.05 seconds, how many clock pulses should be given to the timer? Once again, we have the crystal frequency of 11 megahertz and the timer is incremented so much. So for 0.05 seconds, it has to be incremented 0.05 into 9000, that is 46,080 times. In other words, we can use this formula wherein the total count required will be time required is 0.05 into the crystal frequency F is 11 megahertz divided by 12. So when we do this 0.05 into F is 11 divided by 12, it will give me how much? 46,080. Next, we are talking about the special function registers, the SFRs associated with the timer. The two 16-bit timers, they share two SFRs. One is the TCON and the TMOD, the control register and the mod register to control their operations. These SFRs can be addressed by using their names or addresses. So the these registers we have already have seen. TH0, TL0 together is timer 0. TH1 and TL1 together is timer 1. Then we have the TCON and TMOD. TCON is a timer control register which is having an address 88. TMOD has an address 89. Similarly, TH0 has SFR address 8C. So this is a generic block diagram. So the pulses that comes here, it can be the oscillator pulses divided by 12. As I said, 12 crystal pulses together forms one machine cycle, and it is going to count this machine cycles. Or externally, I can provide some pulses at the T1 pin. And it, if it is counting the external pulses, you can give it to a signal generator or a switch, whatever. So if it is counting that, it is in counter mode. And if it is counting the internal oscillator pulses divided by 12, then it is known as a timer mode. And this is your T mod. In the T mod, I can use the set the C/T bar. If the C/T bar in the T mod is 1, it is in counter mode. If T bar, that is C/T bar equal to 0, it's in the timer mode. And there are in the T mod 8 bits, 4 bits are allocated to timer 0, 4 more bits are allocated to timer 1. In this, 4 bits allocated to timer 0 and timer 1, they're both similar in operation. So M0 and M1 control the mode of the timer. Then C/T bar controls the counter or timer configuration. Then you have one hardware control, that is gate. This gate will control whether it is an internal control or an external control. So for this, I have a, this we have finished. Okay, these are the modes. Okay. As I said, there are two bits, M0 and M1. So the two bits, M0, M1, define the modes. There are four modes. So mode 0, mode 1, mode 2, and mode 3. So mode 0, it is behaving as a 13-bit timer. Mode 1, it is behaving as a 16-bit timer. Mode 2, it is behaving as an 8-bit auto reload. And mode 3, which is extra, it is you get an extra timer, it will be working as a split timer mode. So for the two bits, M0, M1, each of this timer 0, timer 1, they can have four modes. The four modes are mode 0 to mode 3. So in mode 0, it can behave as a 13-bit timer. We have just seen the max count can be FF, that is 256, if it is behaving as an 8-bit timer. If it is behaving as a 16-bit timer, the max count will be 4 Fs, that is 2 to the power 16. Then we have another special mode here, that is mode 0, wherein it's behaving as neither 8-bit nor 16-bit. It is behaving as a 13-bit timer. So once it behaves as a 13-bit timer, the max count will be 2 to the power 13. So the max count will be 2 to the power 13. And out of the two registers, let us say TL0 and TH0. This is a total 16-bit register. Out of the 16-bit registers, only 13 bits are needed for counting operation. And which are the 13 bits that are considered? In higher TH0, all 8 bits are considered. In the lower TL0, only 5 bits are considered. So even similarly in timer 1, out of TL1 and TH1, total 16 bits, only 13 bits are taken. Out of this 13 bits, 8 bits of TH1 and 5 bits of TL1. Then we were talking about the mode 0, complete mode 0 behavior. So in this complete mode 0 behavior, we have TH1 8 bits fully, TL1 only 5 bits. So totally this register is behaving as a 13-bit register. And when it overflows, it will set the interrupt, the timer interrupt flag, that is TF1. If it is timer 0, it will be TF0. The 0 and 1 will specify which timer it is. So the register is, two registers are there, TH1 and TL1. But since it is mode 0, it's a 13-bit counter. TH1 has 8 bits, TL1 has 5 bits. And when it overflows, it will set the TF1 and it will give the interrupt. The input to this register is the clock pulses. The source can be through this crystal oscillator divided by 12 to give you one machine cycle. So if it is in timer mode, C/T bar equal to 0. So it will start counting the machine cycles. And if it is in counter mode, C/T bar, it will be counting the pulses which are given at the T1 pin. T1 is an external pin at the microcontroller. So it will be counting this. Apart from this, we also have the control whether these pulses are fed to the timer or not by the gate signal. So remember, we had this gate C/T bar M1 M0. Similarly, here we had gate C/T bar M1 M0 for timer 0 and timer 1. Here we have seen the function of M0 M1. M0 M1 are the modes. There are four modes, mode 0 to mode 3. Then C/T bar, that is counter/timer. Apart from this, we also have the gate. The gate is a gating control. And when this gating control is used, when the gate is 1, this becomes 0. And the whole interrupt pin will connect it. When the gate is 1, this is becoming 0. And the TR1 will have this. So this will decide whether the TR1 will start the timer or the external interrupt pin will start the timer. To enable the timer, we have to control this. So to control this, we can use a TR1 bit or we can internal control. If I use a TR1, it is an internal control. If I use a INT1 bit, the interrupt pin, then this is external control. So whether you use an internal pin or external pin, that is decided by the gating signal, the gate. So as such, the mode 1 is the same as mode 0, except that this is a 13-bit counter. Instead of a 13-bit counter, mode 1, it will be running with all 16 bits. So it's a 16-bit counter. The rest remains the same. The TCON, I was just talking about TR1 here. Where is this TR1 bit? The TR1 bit is in the TCON register. This is a timer control register. So the timer control register, I'll be explaining in detail later. So here, only thing that we are using is TR1 for timer 1, TR0 for timer 0, then TF0. TF0 is your interrupt here for timer 0. TF1 is an interrupt for timer 1. So these bits, TF1, and TR1 for timer 1. This is, what does a TR1 do? Timer run control. When this is set, it will turn on the timer. Turn on the timer means the clock pulses will be given to the register and the register starts incrementing. If this TR1 equal to 0, though the clock pulses are present, the registers won't increment. They will stay at the same place. The control is given by TR1. And after the registers overflow during counting, it will set the flag. The flag is TF. The whether it is TF0 or TF1 is present, the status is present in the TCON register. So in the TCON register, out of 8 bits, at present we are using the upper 4 bits. Which are the upper 4 bits? TR0, TF0. TR0, timer 0 run control. Then TF0, timer overflow flag, that is TF0. Then similarly, TR1, that is to start the timer. And when the timer overflows, this will be set. We also have what is known as enable IE and IT, the interrupt edge. So this portion we will be doing after we do the interrupts. So we have the next module wherein you're talking about the interrupts. After the in the interrupt portion, this lower 4 bits are used. So in this module, we'll be using only the upper 4 bits. The upper 4 bits are TR0, TF0, TR1, and TF1. Coming to mode 2. Mode 2 is the same operation wherein it is acting as an 8-bit counter. Mode 0 is 13-bit, mode 1 is 16-bit, mode 2 is 8-bit counter. Here you have one feature that is known as automatic reload. So when there is an overflow, the TF is set, the timer interrupt flag is set. At the same time, the TL1 will be reloaded with the contents of TH1. TH1 remains unchanged. So this is an example.
There's an auto reload mode. It's an 8-bit auto reload mode wherein we have the initial value loaded in TH1, and TL1 behaves as an 8-bit counter. The initial value is loaded into TL1, and once this TR1 is enabled, the register TL1 starts counting up from the initial value. Once it reaches the maximum count, that is FF, once it reaches the maximum count FF, it will overflow. Once it overflows, the TF1 interrupt flag is set. At the same time, this TH1 value, the initial value, is reloaded. TH1 doesn't change. Whereas the initial value, the programmer need not has to load it to TL1. You need not have to write a assembly language instruction or a C instruction to load the TL1 with the initial value. Rather, the initial value is loaded in TH1, and that gets reloaded into TL1. Every time there is an overflow, the TH1 value gets reloaded into TL1. So here, TH1 is not behaving as a counter. It is just being used as a storage register where it is storing the 8-bit initial value. Only the TL1 is acting as an 8-bit register. And this starts counting from the initial value, that is in TH1, till FF. It's an 8-bit counter. So the maximum value it can count is up to FF. From FF, again, it will go back to the initial value. The rest is same. This is your crystal oscillator. 12 pulses of this is one machine cycle. Those are counted in timer mode. And if it is an external mode, the clock, if it's behaving as a counter, the external clock pulses are counted. Then you also have a control either through TR1 or the gate. This is mode 2, which is an 8-bit auto reload mode. Then we have mode 3. In mode 3, we have the timer 0 behaving as two 8-bit timers. So we have TL0 as an 8-bit timer, TH0 as an 8-bit timer. Only timer 0. The timer 0 is divided into two timers. TL0 behaves as an 8-bit timer. TH0 also behaves as an 8-bit timer. For TL0, all the control bits of timer 0, which are the control bits? TF0, that is the overflow flag, and TR0 to start the timer. The timer 0, TF0, and TR0 are used by TL0. They are used by TL0. Now, if TH0, the upper 8 bits of the timer 0, also has to behave as a separate timer, a separate parallel timer, it also needs certain control bits. So it will take the TF1 of timer 1 and TR1 of timer 1. It will also behave as an internal timer it will take the crystal oscillator divided by 12. It behaves as a timer, whereas the CL0 can behave as a timer, it can behave as a counter, and it can also have the full functionality. You can use a gate signal, external control, or a TR for starting the timer, which is your internal software control. It can be a software control or a hardware control. So TL0 is an 8-bit timer. It uses the TF0 and TR0 of timer 0. It behaves as a full 8-bit timer slash counter. What about TH0? The TH0 behaves as a timer only. It will count the internal F oscillator by 12. For this, it will use the two signals, the two control signals. The two control signals are TF1 and TR1. What happens to the timer 1? So the timer 1 has TH1 and TL1. Similar to TL0 and TH0 of timer 0, timer 1, TH1 and TL1, the total 16 bits of the timer 1 can be used as a separate timer without the control signals. So it cannot, the timer 1 cannot use TR1 and TF1. Both these are taken over by TH0. Both of them are taken over by TH0. So what about TL1 and TH1, timer 1? The timer 1 can still be operated, and it can be used to generate the baud rate signals. There is a clocking for the serial communication. That is, once you set, it continuously keeps doing it. It doesn't need the TF1 or TR1. So in this mode 3, it looks as if we have three timers. It looks as if we have three timers. The two timers are two 8-bit timers, TL0, TH0, and the third is your timer 1, TH1 and TL1, without the control bits. But still, it can be used to as a baud rate generator for serial communication and all timing operation without the control signals. So mode 3, one advantage of mode 3 is, instead of two timers, it looks as if we have three timers on chip. So let us recap. Mode 0 operation is it's a 13-bit counter or timer. So we have both the timers, timer 0 and timer 1, can operate in mode 0, wherein the counting can be from 00 or any preloaded value, and it can count up to 13 bits. It's a 13-bit counter. Mode 0 is a 13-bit counter. So the 13 bits are TLX 5 bits, TL 5 bits, TH all 8 bits. So all 8 bits are FF. The first D0 to D5, D4 are 1F. So total it can count to 2 to the power 13. After that, it will reset to the initial value. Mode 1 is a 16-bit timer. Mode 0 is a 13-bit timer. Mode 1 is a 16-bit timer. Both the timer 0 and timer 1, both the timers can operate in mode 1, wherein it can count up from 00 to 4Fs. It's a 16-bit timer or counter. So this is the same circuit diagram, wherein you have the crystal oscillator divided by 12, and it can the C slash T bar checks whether you can give an external a clock or an internal clock, and you have the TR to start the timer or the gate, the hardware control, 16 bits, and then the TF1 for overflow. And this is one more timer, that's your timer 2, which is not present in 8051, this is in 8052. So one extra features of this timer 2 has the three operating modes, capture, auto load, and baud rate generator. This is not there in the syllabus, just to go through it. So timer 2 is present only in 8052. And most of the recent microcontrollers have this capture mode, where we can capture the pulse width, everything, that is external signals. We can capture a particular event. Let's recap certain special function registers of 8951 timers that we have studied. TL and TH for timer 0, timer 1. TMOD and TCON for the mode and control registers of timers. And when it is programmed using interrupts, that's in the next chapter, we have IP and IE. So the TCON is bit addressable. And in this TCON, we are using only the upper four bits, TR0, TF0, TR1, TF1 in this module. TMOD is not bit addressable. It's not bit addressable. You have to load the entire register at once. All the 8 bits have to be entered at once. So 4 bits for timer 0, 4 bits for timer 1. So now every out of these 4 bits, 2 bits are mode bits, M0, M1. One is counter slash timer, and the other is the gate bit. So the timer setup, these are the simple examples of the timer setups. So mode 0, 13-bit timer, mode 1 is 16-bit timer, then mode 2 is 8-bit auto reload, mode 3 is 2 8-bit timers, and these are the internal control and external control, wherein we have the gate signal here being 0. The gate is being 0 in this case. Here the gate is 1. So the gate is 1. This is 1000. It becomes 8. And this is 1001. Mode 1. This is 9. So I'll explain this a little later. So this is similarly for timer 1. Let us come to the assembly level language programming of 8051 timers and counters. Till now we have seen the hardware features of the 8051 timers. Let us recap. It has two timers, two 16-bit timers, and each of these timers can be operated as a timer or counter, and they can also be having internal control or external gate control. And third, they have four modes: mode 0, mode 1, mode 2, mode 3. So let us see how to set the modes. The TMOD register, how do we set the TMOD register? The TMOD register, as we said, there is 8 bits, lower 4 for timer 0, upper 4 for timer 1. So for the internal control, gate is 0, external control, gate is 1. For timer operation, the C slash T bar is 0. For counter operation, this is 1. And this is once again the complete 00011011, mode 0, mode 1, mode 2, mode 3. Mode 0, 13-bit, mode 1, 16-bit, mode 2, auto reload, mode 3 is 2 8-bit timers, and timer 1 can be used separately. Then this is a small example. We are configuring timer 0 to run as a 16-bit timer with only internal control. This is second option, wherein we are configuring the same timer 0 to work with external control, or instead of a timer, I can make it to work as a counter. And once again, in a counter, I have the option as an internal or external. So once again, go back to the TMOD. Since we are talking about timer 0, in that TMOD, the upper 4 bits are not used. So since the upper 4 bits are not used, we can make it as 000. And since we are using the internal control, the gate, so for internal control, this is a gate bit. So this is your gate bit. Gate bit is 0. The gate bit is 0. Then I'm using it as a timer. So if you are using the as a timer, this is a D2 bit. So this is a D2 bit of timer 0, C slash T bar. For timer, C slash T bar should be 0. So T bar is 0. Then I have the two mode bits, M0, M1. So since we need a 16-bit timer, so just look at it. For 16-bit timer, it is mode 1. So for 16-bit timer, mode 1 implies M1, M0 equal to 01. So M1, M0 equal to 01. So this is mode 1. This is mode 1. This is timer. And this is internal control. So total value, this is 0, this is 1. So the TMOD value is 01. Similarly, for external control, the gate should be 1. So I'm not using timer 1. So all these are 0, 0. The gate is 1. The gate is 1. Then it's a timer mode. This is the second one is timer. So the second bit C slash T bar is 0. Once again, mode 1 is 0, 1. So in all operation, it is 16 bit. So it's all operation 16 bit. So the mode will not change. So in all of the cases, the last two bits are 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. If it is a counter, the third one, it's a counter. So C slash T bar is 1. So the third and fourth configurations, I need it as a counter. So the C slash T bar in these two cases are 1. And this is internal control, the third one. So the gate is 0. And here the external control gate is 1. So you have the different options. For second, the solution is 0, 9. For the third, the solution is 0, 5. And for the fourth one, the solution is 0, D. 1, 1, 0, 1 is 0, D. So these are the examples of the 3 and 4. And this is a table to configure timer 0 in all possible modes. So when the gate is 0, 13 bit, once again, you have to substitute M1 and M0 as 0, 0 for mode 0. So just work it out. This is for timer 1. And to run both the timers simultaneously, what we have to do is get the value of T mode for timer 0, then get the value of T mode for timer 1. Or both of them. So here I have the timer 1 mod, timer 0 mod. Both of them you calculate separately at once and enter. That is nothing but ORing. So this example is timer 0 in mode 2 and timer 1 as counter in mode 1. When we calculate, you get 02 for the 0, 50 for timer. Add it up, it will be 52. This is your syllabus. Once again, assembly language programming to generate a pulse using mode 1. So let us recap. To get a count n, we first specify what is the time required, the timer, whether I have to wait for 10 milliseconds or 10 microseconds. So that's a time required. Take the time required, multiply by f by 12. F is the crystal frequency divided by 12. So 12 crystal pulses makes up 1 machine cycles. So F by 12 is constant multiplied by the time required. That gives me the count n. So the timer should count so many counts. What will be the initial value to be loaded into the timer? Remember, the timer will overflow from the maximum value. So the initial value to be loaded into the timer will be the maximum value. If it's a 13-bit timer, the maximum value is 2 power 13. If it's a 16-bit timer, the maximum value will be 2 power 16. 8-bit timer, 2 power 8. So take the maximum value, subtract by n. N is a count. So how do you get the n? Time required into f by 12. Time required into f by 12. This will be the initial value that has to be loaded into the registers. The registers are TL, TH, the timer registers, TL, TH. Let us take an example. Write an 8051 assembly language program to generate a delay of 12 microseconds using timer 1 in mode 1 with crystal frequency of 22 megahertz. So first thing that we have to calculate is check out what is the mode required. Here they have specified the mode as mode 1. They may also say it as a 16-bit timer. If they say it's a 16-bit timer, mode 1. It implies it is mode 1. Here they haven't specified it as a 16-bit timer. Rather, they're given the mode directly. It is mode 1. So in mode 1, it's a 16-bit timer. So the maximum count is FFFF, the 4 Fs. So from this is your crystal oscillator, and once you start the timer, the THTL together will count up. It will go to FFF and it will roll out to 0. And once it rolls over to 0, it will set the overflow flag. The TF flag will be set. So the basic thing is, first we know that it's a mode 1. a 16-bit timer. So the maximum value is FFFF. So we have to calculate the initial value that has to be loaded into TLTH. So we have to load it with an initial value. And after loading it with an initial value, the timer must be started. How do you start the timer? So to start the timer, we assuming it's an internal control, we don't have gate, the TR should be set. So you can to set the TR means TR should be made equal to 1. So you can use the instruction set B TR 0 for timer 0. Suppose I'm using timer 1, I have to set to B TR 1. So how do you start the timer? The timer is started by using the assembly instruction set B TR 0 for timer 0. Instead of TR 0 for timer 1, it will be TR 1. After the timer is started, it starts to count up. So you make TR equal to 1. If you make TR equal to 1, the AND gate is enabled. The clock pulses are given to the timer register. The timer's register from the initial value, it will start counting up. And once it counts up to FFF and goes to 0, it will set the TF, that's the overflow flag. It counts up until it reaches the limit of FFF. And when it rolls over from FFF to 00, it sets high a flag bit called the timer flag TF. Now what happens after the timer flag is raised? What do we do? One is we can stop the timer using the instruction clear TR0. So if your TR0, if TR equal to 0, if the TR bit equal to 0, the count will be held and the timer doesn't count. The timer is disabled. Or if you wanted to, suppose I want to generate the same delay again and again. You want the delay to be generated again and again, not once. Then again start the timer. But before you start the timer, again you have to load the initial value into THTL. So there are two options. Once a TF flag, once a timer overflows, as soon as a TF flag overflows, you have to stop the timer. How do you stop the timer? Use a instruction clear TR0 or clear TR1. It will stop the timer. Or the second option is you can repeat the process. Repeat the process and get once more another same amount of delay. To repeat the process, what do we do? The THTL are reloaded with the original value and the flag, the TF, the timer flag was set to 1 when it overflow. So you have to clear it to 0 so that it is enabled again. So to repeat the process, what should we do? The THTL, the timer register, should be reloaded with the original value and TF should be cleared to 0. The TF should be cleared to 0. So once again, come back to the program. So we'll come back to the question. The question is, write an 8051 assembly language program to generate a delay of 12 microseconds using timer 1 and mode 1, given the crystal frequency is 22 megahertz. So I've taken a small snapshot of this. So the delay is 12 microseconds using timer 1 in mode 1 and crystal frequency is 22 megahertz. First, we have to check what should be put in the T mode. We have to configure the timer. To configure the timer, we have to program the T mode register. So in the T mode register, since I'm not using timer 0, this can all be 0000. Timer 0 is 000. I'm using timer 1. And in timer 1, I'm using mode 1. So mode 1 means M0, M1 is 01. And I'm using it as a timer. So for a timer, it is C/T bar, so it is 0. And I'm using the internal control TR. I'm not using the gate signal. So the gate is 0. So the total value that I have to put is the upper 4 bits is 0001, that is 1. And the lower 4 bits are 000. So the T mode value is 10. The 10H should be loaded. So one half of the question we have done. Which is the one half of the question? First, configuring the T mode register. This will tell you which timer we are using. We are using timer 1. And in the timer 1, we are using mode 1. And this timer, we are using it in timer mode. And we are using TR. We are not using gate. So the gate is made 0. And this is loaded into T mode register. Next, we have to compute the initial count value. So we have to generate a delay of 12 microseconds. So the required delay is 12 microseconds. So the n that is required is required delay into crystal frequency by 12. The required delay is 12 microseconds. The given crystal frequency is 22 megahertz. So 12 microseconds into 22 megahertz divided by 12 gives your n. And what is the initial value that you should load? The maximum value is minus n. Maximum value minus the count. So the maximum value here, it is timer 1 and mode 1. So the maximum value is 16 bit. So 2 power 16. So that is all FFFFH minus. When you compute this, this comes out to be 22. The 12 gets cancelled. Micro is 10 power minus 6. Mega is 10 power plus 6. They get cancelled. Only 22 is remaining. So you get 65513 in decimal. And what will be the initial value? Plus 1. So hex, you are counting from 00 to 255, or 00 to actual count will be initial value minus 1. So bring that here, plus 1. So this is the value. Use a calculator, convert this BCD to hexadecimal value. So the hexadecimal value will be FFEAH. So this is the initial value to be loaded in THTL. So here EA is the lower part, lower 8 bits. So TL1 should be loaded with EA. And we are using timer 1. Since we are using timer 1, THTL will be TH1 and TL1. So for TL1, you load EA. For TL1, you load EA. For TH1, you load FF. So the required delay is 12 microseconds. So multiply the 12 microseconds into crystal frequency by 12. That gives your N. Take the maximum value. That's your timer 1 and mode 1. Mode 1 is 2 power 16. That is 65535 minus N. And to that, you get the initial value. Convert it into hexadecimal, and in the 16-bit hexadecimal, put it in a timer register, 16-bit timer register. The 16-bit timer register is timer 1, so this is TH1 and TL1. TL1 will contain EA and TH1 should contain FF. So this is your assembly level language program. In the assembly level language program, what should we do first? First, we have to load the TMOD register. We have to configure the timer and its mode. So we have computed T mode is equal to 10 in H. Hash, it is the immediate value, 10 H. So this is a T mode. T mode is in hexadecimal 0001, that is 100. So the T mode is 10 H. So move the T mode register with the immediate value, 10 in hexadecimal. Next. We have to load the initial value. TL1 is EA, TH1 is FF. Move TL1 with the immediate value. Since it is EA, precede it with a 0. Hash 0 EAH. Similarly, move TH1 hash, since it is F, so 0F. So if anything is from A to F, it should be preceded with 0. Suppose if it is 98, 9F, no need to precede with 0. You can directly say hash. See here, hash 10. Similarly, I can say hash 90 or 9B or 9A hash. But if the first value is anything from A to F, it should be preceded with a 0. Otherwise, it will take it as a character. So move TL1 hash 0EAH. Similarly, move TH1 hash 0FFH. So the initial values are loaded into the timer registers TL1 and TH1. Start the timer. How do you start the timer? I'm not using gate. Rather, I'm using TR1. Set B TR1. Start the timer. TR1 equal to 1. As soon as TR1 equal to 1, the clock pulses are given to this register, TL and TH, and the register starts incrementing. So start the timer, and after starting the timer, set B TR1. You wait till TF1 becomes 1. So you keep waiting. Why should you wait? You have to wait till the timer overflows. So J and B, jump on, no borrow. So what are we comparing? TF1. So if TF1 is 0, If TF1 is 0, you go back here. If TF1 is not 0, you do not wait, you go to the next instruction. Which is the next instruction? Now here you have an option. You have the option whether to repeat or stop. But anyway, first stop the timer, clear the timer 1. And let us say you want to repeat the process. So if you have to repeat the process, clear the flag, clear the TF1 and S jump again. So go back again, wherein you reload the initial value, start the timer. So once you start the timer, you get the next 12 microsecond delay and you can continue. So what does the assembly level language program do? First, configure the timer using TMOD, load the initial value into TL1, TH1, start the timer, wait till the timer overflows. Till the timer will count up to FFF, that is, it counts the N clock cycles. And once it counts the N clock cycles, it means that 12 microseconds are over. Once the 12 microseconds are over, the TF flag is set. Once it is set, this is not true. Rather, it will come to the next instruction where we stop the timer. Then if you want to repeat it, again, we are going to clear the overflow flag and we jump again, wherein we reload the initial value again, start the timer and repeat the process. So this is a small program to generate a 12 microsecond delay using assembly level language program. The syllabus mentions only ALP, but in your old syllabus, you had ALP and C. To be on the safer side, let us see the C program also. Once you have the assembly level language program, writing it in C is simpler, or directly you can write it in C. What is required? The flow is required, the flow chart. What is the flow? Configure the timer, load the initial value, start the timer, wait till the timer overflows, then stop the timer and repeat again. So in C, you usually start with hash include the registers 51.h. So all the special registers are accessed directly by the names TH, TL, TMOD. You don't need to use the addresses. Then any C program uses a starting void main function. Inside TMOD equal to 0x, it's a hexadecimal value, 0x10. So in assembly level language, you say hash 10h, move TMOD equal to hash 10h. This is in C, we write TMOD equal to 0x10, while 1. It's a continuous loop, right? Because we are using sjump again. This is your sjump again. So it's a continuous loop, while 1. You load TL1 with EA, TH1 with FF. So TL1 is loaded with 0xEA, TH1 is loaded with 0xFF. The hexadecimal values, that is the initial value, are loaded into TH1, TL1. Then you have to start the timer. So start the timer means TR1 equal to 1. Then you wait till timer 1 equal to 00. While TF1 equal to 00, equal to 0, you keep waiting. You do not do anything. You just keep waiting here. Once TF1 equal to 1, once the timer register overflows from the maximum value, TF is set. So it will come out of this while loop. Then here, what are we doing? We are stopping the timer 1. So clear timer 1, that is TR1 equal to 0, stop the timer. Then this flag, which was set here, TF1 equal to 1, it has set. So it came out of the while loop. So start the process again, make TF1 equal to 0. And go back here, this is the inside of the while loop, wherein you reload the initial value again, then start the timer, wait till TF1 equal to 0, and once it becomes 1, come out of the while loop, stop the timer and repeat the process. So today we have covered the timer hardware, both the timer 0, timer 1, along with the modes. And we have done an assembly level language programming to generate a 12 microsecond delay. In the next session, we will continue further on the timers and the ALP for other modes and the square wave. Thank you.